experiences together, Harry and I have been friends for, golly, almost 2 decades now.
Yeah.
And it's it's always a surprise, isn't it, Harry?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. All right. Well, anyway, I'd like to welcome you to the Rock United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you're here. We'd also like to welcome the people that are joining us via the internet, www.therockumc.com. It's a blessing that you're here. We're so glad to have you. There's so many other places that we could be, some of them good and some of them bad, and we're glad that you're here with us today. If you would, bow your heads with me for the opening prayer. Blessed Lord, we're gathered here in your house, in your name, and we're praying for your presence throughout this worship service. Lord, we come in humility and we come in faith. We're immensely grateful for the abundance that you give us, each one of us. We depend on your love, your grace, and your blessings to get through our day, and you've never failed us. Lord, we also send prayers spoken and some unspoken that only you know. We ask for your care, guidance, strength, courage, and wisdom as we face each day as disciples. And we pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Please stand for the call to worship and then remain standing for the offertory prayer.
Okay. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. And then this, coming to this presence and singing. Know that the Lord is God.
It is he that made us, and we are his.
We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving
and his courts be his praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good.
His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Amen. Continue bow, please. God, we are made in your image, so in your generosity, we pray that you would make us generous. In your faithfulness, make us faithful. You're a God of abundance, and we are very, very grateful for all that we get. So that whatever gift we bring to you today might be an offer of worship, we offer you these gifts as we continue on with our worship service. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Amen. Please, would you go ahead, Harry.
Okay. Please remain standing for the offertory prayer.
No, we've had that. We changed our liturgy a little bit. Pass the peace.
Pass the peace. Please, I'm sorry about that. Please greet your neighbors.
How you doing?
Thank you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Karen, peace be with you. Ashley, peace be with you. Good to see you again, sweetie. I can't wait to do it. It'd be great. Peace be with you, Mary. Peace be with you. God bless you, sir. Thank you. Peace be with you. God bless you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Good morning, church. I got my hair done this morning and nobody commented on it. What is the deal with that, you know? Men's ministry prayer, would you bow your heads, please? Blessed Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise your holiness and are grateful for your presence in our life. Thank you for working in our lives and guiding us to salvation. Help us to see you more clearly, to recognize your influence every day. Lead us in your will. Help us walk in the full spirit of God. Grant us love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning to all. Our first reading today is from Exodus 32, verses 1 through 10. When the people saw Moses was when the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing, and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then he said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterwards, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. When the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people whom you brought out of Egypt have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol in the cast, idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation."
Please stand and let's sing "At the Cross."
It's all that I can. A reading from Exodus chapter 32, 11 through 18. But Moses sought the favor of the Lord, his God. Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people, whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. Moses turned and went down the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant law in his hands. They were inscribed on both sides, front and back. The tablets were the work of God. The writing was the writing of God, engraved on the tablets. When Joshua heard the noise of the people shouting, he said to Moses, there is the sound of war in the camp. Moses replied, it is not the sound of victory. It is not the sound of defeat. It is the sound of singing that I hear. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and sing, Here I Am to Worship.
Say that you're my God.
You may be seated.
The third reading today is from Exodus 32, 19 through 24. When Moses approached the camp and saw the calf and the dancing, his anger burned, and he threw the tablets out of his hands, breaking them to pieces at the foot of the mountain. And he took the calf the people had made and burned it in the fire. Then he ground it to powder, scattered it on the water, and made the Israelites drink it. He said to Aaron, "What did these people do to you that you led them into such great sin?" "Do not be angry, my lord," Aaron answered. "You know how prone these people are to evil." Then he said to me, "Make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." So I told them, "Whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off." Then they gave me the gold, and I threw it into the fire, and out came this calf. Please stand for the gospel reading.
Today's gospel reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 24 through 33. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or stow away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, "What shall we eat?" Or, "What shall we drink?" Or, "What shall we wear?" For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated, and the children may join Lori for the kids' rock.
Name it is the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. Separate us now. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. Your silence the burst of sin. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom.
Song always gets me a little choked up. It's amen. Huh? It's powerful. It is a powerful, powerful song. So I mentioned in our welcome that sometimes we're in good places and sometimes we're not. 30 years ago, I was in Bosnia, and I was doing a survey there for the preparation for us to help calm the war that was going to go down there. At the same time, in the next 2 days was the Battle of Mogadishu. And some of you have heard me preach about this before, and that's not what I'm preaching about today. But the Battle of Mogadishu was where we lost a number of soldiers fighting and had gone to arrest the lieutenants of Mohammed Aidid. And I lost 8 friends there in that battle. And so I was thinking today, this morning when I was saying my prayers, that you know, we find ourselves We find ourselves in good places and we find ourselves in bad places. And we have to understand that those things will always change. Those things will always change with God. Our story today, we read this, and I've titled this American Idol, Atry, American Idol, Idolatry, is a story of Aaron, the Hebrews, and the golden calf. And this is a remarkable story. You see, Moses has left the camp with Joshua, and he's gone up Mount Sinai, and he's getting instruction from God. And people have left the camp. They don't know what's going on, and they've also taken leave of their minds because they have been walking across the wilderness. They've stopped at Mount Sinai. Moses says, stay here. He leaves his brother Aaron in charge. Aaron is the head of the priests. He's the high priest. He leaves Aaron in charge. He goes up with Joshua, and they go up to the mountain. God gives them all kinds of instructions. They're going to build a tabernacle. He tells them exactly how. They're going to worship. He tells them exactly how. He's going to appoint priests. He tells them exactly how. He's given them the law. He starts off with the simplest of things, the Ten Commandments, this very simplest law that there is. So Moses starts heading down, and he hears singing as he enters the camp, and they wonder if they heard sounds of war at first, but no, they hear singing. And when he gets there, he discovers that the people have built an idol. Moses is furious. Ellen would say he was livid. Things are not going to go well. Moses, holding the commandments that God made with his own hands, throws them down and breaks them into little pieces. I can't even imagine. Moses confronts his brother Aaron. He's been in charge while they're gone. And he goes, what is going on here? And Aaron lies to Moses. How did he get away with this? He says, well, the gold just kind of fell into the fire. And surprise, this brilliant golden idol came out. As if he had nothing to do with it. And yet God is going to forgive him. In the end, though, the people pay for their transgressions. God strikes them with a plague. Moses grinds up the gold and makes them drink it. That can't be fun. Worst of all, I think, Moses actually commands the tribe of Levi to execute brothers and friends, and 3,000 die for their disobedience and their worship of this idol. I have some empathy for these folks. This was, at the time, a time of no law whatsoever. None. This was a natural thing for them to do, to seek. They were afraid. They were searching for something. They thought Moses was gone. He'd been gone quite some time. In ancient times, people always tried to reach out to powers they did not understand. I suppose we do that too. You know, if you wanted back then, if you wanted prosperity, good weather, you wanted to win a battle, or you needed fertility for whatever reason, you sought help from a higher power, but you didn't know what that higher power was. People made sacrifices to the idols of the sun, the moon, the trees, the earth, the water, the fire, stones, you name it. They were sacrifices to idols. They knew they needed a God. They just didn't know where to look for that God or where they might find him. Now, sophisticated local craftsmen like Aaron, they could actually form an idol for you. It could be something as big as a golden calf or something smaller you could keep in your pocket, and you could carry it around with you. It might be made out of wood, rock, precious stones, precious metals. Could be any of those things. Later, we know from reading about from Paul, the Greeks and the Romans still did those things. They built extravagant temples to idols. And they created unholy rites in those temples that included prostitution and other sacrifices and things just that our God would never do. In some places today, there are still idols. Do you know that the Hindu religion actually has 33 gods, 33 named gods? Buddhists don't have any gods, but they have millions of supernatural characters that can help or hinder you. We can find statues of Buddha in many Asian restaurants that we go to. You might walk in and you see the Buddha there, and they might have some food spread around him. That's an idol. An idol is anything that we place ahead of God the Father in our lives. Idols are seductive. They're subtle, but they have real power over us. Have you ever been seduced? I have. It was 1976. I'd graduated from high school, and I was working two jobs, and I hung drywall during the days, and at night I made pizzas. Life was simple. I was satisfied until I saw her. She was awesome. She had these crazy curves. She was as hot as a Texas branding iron. I tell you, my dad had told me to stay away from the fast ones, but I could not resist. She was a 1970 Olds 442, biggest production engine in the GM line. Oldsmobile V8, 455 cubic inch, 370 horsepower. Ooh, I had to have it. She was this deep gloss black and just absolutely beautiful. My dad told me, he said, you shouldn't buy that. I bought it anyway. He said, I couldn't park it at his house. I moved out. He said, if I moved out, he wasn't going to pay for my college. I said, okay, I'll pay for that myself. Didn't know how I was going to do it. Do you see how this is going? I was ready to ruin a relationship for an object. I was willing to disrespect the will of my father for an object. This is not a time that I'm proud of. I was in a self-destructive track. I needed some guidance. I didn't have any money left. I was in debt. But I did own one of the Detroit's most powerful muscle cars ever. I was willing to give up nearly everything I had for this. It had become an idol to me. And idols can be anything. Self, money, any possession that you might have, property, power, influence, drugs, alcohol, sex, any of those things. Idols can be created from desire for beauty, wealth, experiences, influence. As Christians, our idols may not be near, we may not even recognize them. We may not be clear about them at all. Today, the golden calf could be money, prestige, or success. Oh, there she is, by the way. You might be thinking, I don't have any idols. Are you sure? Because some pursue adoration by others as their goal. They want to be adored, and they will work on that as their goal, and that becomes their idol. How about sports teams? Football, basketball. Now, I love NCAA football. I'm a huge fan of the SEC. My church knows that. What is it that drives us to cheer on a group of people who play a game? Well, it gives us an identity, doesn't it? Their wins are our wins. Their losses are our losses. We have an emotional attachment to it. But you know, if you were to meet Dax Shepard in the airport, he probably wouldn't talk to you that much. For those of you who don't know, that's a quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys, who, by the way, got beat by Phoenix last week. Can you imagine? Anyway, I saw this on TV Friday. Travis Kelce is a great football player. And Taylor Swift is a very, very talented singer. And the big question nowadays is, are they together? Who cares? Why would anyone possibly care about something like that? But they become idolistic to us. These are important people. They might make an important couple. They become an idol to us. Can you imagine the power of a church that was as enthusiastic in faith as those people who follow the Longhorns? What a church that would be. They couldn't stop us, could they? How do you know something becomes an idol in your life? Because an idol drives your behavior. It takes your mind away from God. Now, self-image can be an idol. Jobs and identities can be idols. If you lost your job, think about this for a second. If you lost your job, would you feel like you were less of a person? Perhaps. That can be a big deal. But you have to remember, you're a child of God. You are still you. You are still loved. You may have a disappointment, but you can overcome it with the Lord. It may be hard, but don't let that job become an idol. Some people value their jobs and their titles excessively, and you've seen these. People who call themselves professor, president, chairman, chief, owner, director, doctor, senator, and I hate to say it, sometimes even pastor. Some people will sell their souls for a title. How about the way we look? Is that an idol to you? Some people idolize their personal appearance. look at the advertisements on TV. You got to lose weight, and you got to use this makeup, and you got to do this, and you got to do that. All these things that really none of us need to do. Is appearance to you more important than health? Have you ever known someone with an eating disorder? Bulimia, maybe? People can go to extremes with almost anything. Many of you know that I practiced medicine for 40 years, and I knew a young man that abused testosterone. He had this imperfect dream of this physical perfection. He wanted to pump iron. He wanted to lift weights. He wanted to do all the things to make himself what he believed was more beautiful. He wanted people to notice him, too. He wore T-shirts that were two sizes too small, and he had huge biceps and triceps and legs like tree trunks. He also had severe infections from the cystic acne that comes with hormone abuse. He had episodes of steroid rages that caused him problems at work and at school. Unfortunately, even in a short time, he was taking so much of this, his liver began to fail. But even after he was diagnosed, he couldn't give it up. He continued to do what the people who abuse these things call pull the trigger. And he continued to pull the trigger. When last I saw him, he was dying because steroids were his idol. What are some other idols? Well, we idolize property and things, don't we? Some people find identity and success in what they own. Some look down on folks who don't have what they have. And conversely, you can idolize someone who has something that you don't have. Money, jewels, gold, collectibles, art, boats, cars, recreational vehicles, guns, guitars, you name it. You can have something that you idolize. How about the size of your bank account, your wealth, your property? Or how about anything else that makes you feel superior? You know, we shouldn't. Galatians 2:8 tells us that we're all one in Christ Jesus. We are all one in Christ Jesus. How about fashion? Labels and brands can become idols. Vera Wang, I had to learn how to pronounce this. Givenchy, spelled Givenchy. Anyway, Louis Vuitton, Michael Kors, Versace, all those things can become idols. Our founder, John Wesley, was an Anglican priest, and he told us that we should make all that we can, save all that we can, and give all that we can. We have to keep things in perspective. Now, money's not bad to have. Neither is the desire to earn it. It's what you do with it that matters. If you do the right things with the blessings that you've received, you are walking with Christ. If you're not, you're not. In Mark 10:17-31, there's a story about the young ruler. I think it's a great story. It's one of the sad stories in Scripture. The young ruler comes up to Jesus, and this is in Mark, by the way. He says, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus told him, "You needed to keep the commandments." He says, "I've done that since I was a child." He swore to Jesus that this is the way that he had lived. Jesus says, "That's good. Then do this. Sell everything that you possess, give it to the poor, and you'll have treasures in heaven, and come follow me." But the young man was sad, and he left. He was grieving because he owned a lot of property. He had a lot to give up. Brothers and sisters, the only thing that you can worship that will satisfy you is Jesus Christ. You see, God still cares about what we worship. What we worship stays with us. It becomes our identity. Do you worship God as a Christian, or do you worship some of these other things? You know, this young man probably died a rich old man without salvation. You know, most of the things that we want won't actually satisfy us. You just leave wanting more. I mean, oh, here's some another group. Substances. Substances can be idols. Drugs, alcohol, food. You know, if you're angry when you can't have something, that thing has become an idol. If others control you because of it, you have begun to worship and to demand and want more than God that substance. If you hurt others because of your desires or habits, you're worshiping an idol. When something that we own, eat, drink, inject, or otherwise can hurt someone, can cause someone else harm, it's an idol. Sex. Are you willing to ignore Scripture? When we engage in intimate behaviors that are harmful or dangerous, sex has become an idol. Forcing intimate relations through coercion, bullying, or intimidation makes sex an idol. Now, physical intimacy should be treated with this reverent desire that God has given us. It's completely appropriate. Mark 10:7 actually tells us, "For this reason shall a man leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." Men, God says that you're supposed to treat and love your wives as Christ loved the church. Jesus was a servant leader. Servant leader. He lived for others. Christ loved the church and he gave his life for us. Women, God says you should submit yourselves to your husbands as you do to the Lord. As you do to the Lord. When a husband submits to God and loves his wife, her natural reaction is to have this intimacy and love for her husband because he's treating her like Christ would. Here's one, and it's always controversial. You can idolize your family. You can objectify your spouse, and that can be idol worship. Your spouse is not your property, neither are your children. They are your responsibility. Giving into the refusals or demands of a child in your care because you love them is a lie. Let me say that again. When you give into the refusals or demands of a child in your care because you love them, you're lying to yourself. The reason that we give into something that they refuse or demand that's not good for them is because we don't love them enough to say no. Now, love can become an idol worship. We can misfire on that. God comes first in our lives, or should. We can love and be jealous over relationships with our spouses in a right way or a wrong way. Brothers, if you feel resentment because someone is simply talking to your wife, then you are being self-centered, possessive, and selfish, and controlling. That's insecurity on your part. She's become an idol to you. On the other hand, if someone is trying to steal the affection of your wife, you have reason to be righteously angry and protective. It would be a violation of God's holy standards otherwise. It's all about balance and context and God's word in our lives. It really comes down to that, doesn't it? God's word. Sometimes we lose a sense of who we are, where we are, and that God is our maker and our savior. We don't want to redefine God as something less than he is. We don't want to forsake the God that's been revealed in us in Scripture, who gave Moses the Ten Commandments, gave him the laws, has given us promise after promise after promise, and then gave Jesus Christ to us as the New Testament, the promise of our salvation. Some want a kinder, gentler, and more tolerant and less demanding God. Many pastors fall into this trap of preaching this guilt-free life. Because we have salvation, we can do whatever we want. Nope. There's still an accounting. There's an accounting for what we worship. We can backslide. We don't want to do that. Some say some sell God as a bad makeover. They make him a weak little God with a little g. They make him made in our image, not in his image, not us as his creation. These are made over gods created by men, and to worship them is to worship an idol. Worshiping a personal God who is not scriptural is worshiping an idol. That's not any different than carving one out of stone or crafting one from gold. If you are worshiping something that is not God the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, then you are worshiping an idol. What does the word worship mean? It's expression of adoration and reverence that we have for God. We all know what adore means. It's a strong love. What is reverence? It's an attitude where we honor the Lord, express our gratitude, and demonstrate our obedience. That means that we practice means of grace like prayer and scripture reading and fasting and tithing and all those things that come with being a member of a church. So what does all that mean? Well, it means that we don't do those things only when things get tough. Prayer, Listen to this. Prayer is not God's ambulance call. Prayer is not God's ambulance call. Prayer and worship are the bumpers that keep us from having the crash that makes us call the ambulance. We have to be proactive in our love for God. We have to be proactive in our worship of God. We are saved through worship, and we serve the Lord. And as the scripture we read today says, we can't serve two masters. Life is more than money, food, clothes, and other possessions. God is where our trust and obedience goes. Pagans run after things. Those are non-Christians. Pagans run after things. God knows what we need. But we're to seek his kingdom and righteousness first, and then all those other things are going to come to us. I always challenge my church, nearly always. This week, I want you to look for the things that you might be idolizing. If you don't know if something is an idol to you, but if you really crave it, put it away for a couple of days and see how that does for you. You know why? Because when you put away the idols, you come closer to our loving Savior. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We have a rare gift this morning. We get to celebrate two sacraments. We have a baptism, and then we're going to share communion. Now, Christian baptism is fundamental to the ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus, the risen Lord. Baptism is a gift from God for all of us in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. After his resurrection, Jesus sent his disciples into the world, and he didn't ask them to do this. He commanded them to baptize. It's an outward sign of this inward desire to be in the loving embrace of God. It's a link to our common belief in discipleship, and it unites us in our faith. It's God's gift, and it's our response to that gift. This is so important. I'm honored to do every baptism that I do, but today is special. Ashley, who I'll be baptizing in just moments, is the granddaughter of Jay Maxfield and his wife Karen. Jay was my once-in-a-lifetime friend and my brother in Christ. He's gone now, but his family continues in steadfast love and service to the Lord, and that's a blessing to all of us. So today, as Ashley is baptized into a union with Christ, I know that her granddad is pleased, and I know that if I looked up my eyes to the sky, that Jay's looking down, and he's got a smile on his face. What a blessing that was. So, Ashley, Karen, would you come up? Lori, is Harry free? Harry's with the children, isn't he? Come on up, Ashley. Good to see you, sweetie. You can stand right next to me. I'm going to ask you some questions, and then I'm going to ask the congregation some questions, okay? All right, good. Yeah, come on in. All right, hi. I'm Michael. Nice to see you. There's my lay leaders. Oh. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we're initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us at no price. Brothers and sisters, I present for baptism Ashley. On behalf of the whole church, Ashley, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and power that God has given you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever form it may take? Yes. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Yes. Do you put your whole trust in his grace and promise to serve him as your Lord? Yes. Are you in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Yes. According to the grace given to you, will you remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church and serve as his representative here on earth? Will you sponsor church this candidate who supports and encourages them in their Christian life? Yes. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? We do. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith the life and include this person now before you in your care. Trust of God and be found faithful in her service. We will pray for her and she may be true disciple who walk in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures, the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
Yes. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
Believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land that you promised.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell God's mercy each day.
In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and to those who receive it to wash away their sins, to clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory.
All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who is in you and the Holy Spirit, who lives and reigns forever.
Amen. Come with me, put your hands on your shoulder. Ashley, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit work within you that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. I seal you in Jesus Christ. Now it is our joy to welcome this new sister in Christ, Ashley. Through baptism, you are incorporated into the Holy Spirit, into God's new creation, and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a new member of the family of Christ. I would ask that every one of you would take an opportunity to give Ashley a hug or a handshake when they leave today. Members of the household of God, I commend Ashley to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit that you may live in grace and peace. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Congratulations. God bless you. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts. Bless the Lord. Praised in heaven, praised on earth, praised throughout creation. The trees of the fields rejoice in your salvation. The stars shine out in your glory. Winds and waters scatter at the sound of your voice, and we with all of creation cry, Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Christ who comes in your name. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. You have shown us the truth, the light, and the way. With your disciples, on the night of your betrayal, you took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it, saying, When dinner was done, you took a cup, saying, giving thanks, and gave it, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the New Testament, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. We receive these gifts, the body and blood of Christ, and as we receive thee, we rejoice in the knowledge of our salvation. Make us whole and holy on this day as we wait until that day when we will all be in your blessed presence forever. This is not Michael's table. This is not a Methodist table. This is a table for all people. I invite everyone. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Paul. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Pat. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Terry. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Holly. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Audrey. That's the blood of Christ spilled for you. Eric, the blood of Christ spilled for you, brother. The blood of Christ spilled for you. 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 The blood of Christ spilled for you, little brother. I'll give you two. There's one for him, and you can choose it. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. You got it. Oh, look at that. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Ashley. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Karen. And you. The blood of Christ spilled for 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 you, Sophie. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Slat. Spilled for you, Dennis. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Mary. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Thomas. The blood of Christ spilled for you, brother. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Lori. The blood of Christ spilled for you, Shalana. The blood of Christ spilled for you. Cindy, the blood of Christ spilled for you. Harry, the blood of Christ spilled for you. Is there anyone who's not yet been able to take? Pat? The body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ spilled for you. Thanks be to God. Would you bow your heads with me? Blessed Father, we are so grateful for these sacraments that we were able to do today with these loving people for this child of God. We appreciate, Lord, the abundance that you give us, the wondrousness of this ability to come into your presence, the presence of the Holy Spirit here with us today. Lord, we pray that you would watch over those who are here and whose prayers are unspoken, and also for those who are traveling and away from the church today. Once again, Lord, we are so grateful for all that you give us, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
So I'm happy to report there our lady shopping trip returned yesterday safe and sound with lots of goodies, and I think we have a photo we're going to put up just so y'all can see. We rented scooters, and we had so much fun. It was so much fun, and I'm hoping that we'll get to do it again in the spring, right, Lori? Yes, and so if you didn't get to go this time, you'll have another chance to go, but it was a great time. Also, please remember to get your tickets for the dinner and comedy show. Our beautiful Alyssa is going to be singing a few numbers as well, and I know you will not want to miss out on that. So we do have those tickets for sale. Please stand and let's sing Hymn of Heaven.
To be the heir of heaven, the pain is gone, your mercy fills the streets. To look upon the one who bled to save me, and walk with you for all eternity. Songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, and in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. The heroes are the faith.
a thousand generations. Sing, worthy was the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy was the Lamb who was slain.
Thank you so much for joining us today. What a blessing it was to have you. We'd like to say goodbye to those folks that are watching us via the internet. What a great day, especially 2 days of two times of sacraments, huh? May the power of God Almighty, the love of Jesus Christ, and the help of the Holy Spirit be with you until we meet again. Amen. Don't lose it. It's so good to hear. Yes, ma'am. Yep, that's the rock box. Thank you so much for coming. See you next week. Well, I won't see you next week. I have a shipment. I'm going to be in Ohio. But John Nicholson will be here. He was one of my mentors. Great guy. Thank you so much for coming. What a blessing. And you. Are you? Do you go to church with Karen? Oh, great. Yeah. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. We love that family forever. No doubt. Oh, our pleasure. Thank you for coming.
Beautiful Savior, glorious God.
Hi, Stephen. I'm Michael. Nice to meet you. Great. Yeah. Yes, I saw you. Got you. Okay. Oh, she's already gone. Made out.